from cellar to garret, the significance of the hut. In French, translated passage from Pierre Albert Huron. At the door of the house, who will come knocking? An open door, we enter. A closed door, a den. The world pulse beats beyond my door. House, quite obviously, is a privileged entity for a phenomenological study of the intimate values of inside space, provided, of course, that we take it in both its unity and its complexity, and endeavor to integrate all the special values in one fundamental value. For the house furnishes us dispersed images and a body of images. At the same time, in both cases, I shall prove that imagination augments the values of reality. A sort of attraction for images concentrates them about the house. This makes sense to me right now, especially right now. Transcending our memories of all the houses in which we have found shelter, above and beyond all the houses we have dreamed we live in, can we isolate an intimate, concrete essence that would be a justification of the uncommon value of all of our images of protected intimacy? This, then, is the main problem. In order to solve it, it is not enough to consider the house as an object on which we can make our judgments and daydreams react. For a phenomenologist, a psychoanalyst, or a psychologist, these three points of view being named in the order of decreasing efficacy. What a burn. It is not a question of describing houses or enumerating features and analyzing for which reasons they are comfortable. On the contrary, we must go beyond the problems of description, whether this description be objective or subjective, that is, whether it gives facts or impressions, in order to attain the primary virtues, those that reveal an attachment that is native in some way to the primary function of inhabiting. A geographer or an ethnographer can give us descriptions of very varied types of dwellings. In each variety, the phenomenologist makes the effort needed to seize upon the germ of the essential, sure, immediate well-being it encloses. In every dwelling, even the richest, the first task of the phenomenologist is to find the original shell. The related problems are many if we want to determine the profound reality of all the subtle shadings of our attachment for a chosen spot. For a phenomenologist, these shadings must be taken as the first rough outlines of a psychological phenomenon. The shading is not an additional superficial coloring. We should therefore have to say how we inhabit our vital space, in order, in accord with all the dialectics of life, how we take root day after day in a quote, corner of the world. For our house is our corner of the world. As has often been said, it is our first universe, a real cosmos in every sense of the word. If we look at it intimately, the humblest dwelling has beauty. authors of books on the humble home often mention this feature of the poetics of space, but this mention is much too succinct. Finding little to describe in the humble home, they spend little time there. So they describe it as it actually is, without really experiencing its primitiveness. A primitiveness which belongs to all, rich and poor alike, if they are willing to dream. But our adult life is so disposed of the essential benefits. Its anthropocosmic ties have become so slack that we do not feel their first attachment in the universe of the house. There is no dearth of abstract, world-conscious philosophers who discover a universe by means of the dialectical game of the I and the non-I. In fact, they know the universe before they know the house, the far horizon before the resting place, whereas the real beginnings of images, if we study them phenomenologically, will give concrete evidence of the values of inhabited space. Of the non-I protects the I. Indeed, here we touch upon a converse whose images we shall have to explore. All really inhabited space bears the essence of the notion of home. In the course of this work, we shall see that the imagination functions in this direction whenever the human being has found the slightest shelter. We shall see. I'm gonna pause here for a second. Just write down some things that we've read that I want to underline. Just to go back to later. Just so you know. Underline a part earlier where we talked about the job to be finding the original shell. And then when he started talking about from our house is our corner of the world. I really like that. Basic, true. A lot. He said from that. And talking about the non eye. This last thing we just started reading, I stopped because I won't underline. Okay, I'm gonna start the paragraph again. Thank you for being patient. Indeed. Here we touch upon a converse whose images we shall have to explore. All really inhabited space bears the essence of the notion of home. The notion. In the course of this work, we shall see that the imagination functions in this direction whenever the human being has found the slightest shelter. We see the imagination build walls of impalpable shadow. With the illusion of protection, or just the contrary, tremble behind thick walls, mistrust the staunchest ramparts. In short, in the most interminable of dialectics, the sheltered being gives perceptible limits to his shelter. He experiences the house in its reality and in its virtuality, by means of thought and dreams. It is no longer in its positive aspects that the house is really lived. nor is it only in the passing hour that we can recognize its benefits. An entire past comes to dwell in a new house. I like that. An entire past comes to dwell in a new house. That's true. The old saying, we bring our lairs with us, has many variations. And the daydream deepens to the point where an immemorial domain opens up for the dreamer of a home beyond man's earliest memory. The house, like a fire, will permit me, later in this work, to recall flashes of daydreams that illuminate the synthesis of immemorial and recollected. In this remote region, memory and imagination remain associated. Memory and imagination remain associated. Each one working for their mutual deepening. Associated, each one working for their mutual deepening. In the order of values, they both constitute a community of memory and image. Imagination, image. That makes some sense to me. Image of vision. A community of memory and image. Thus, the house is not experienced from day to day only, on the thread of a narrative or in the telling of our own story. Through dreams, the various dwelling places in our lives co-penetrate and retain the treasures of former days. And after we are in the new house, when memories of other places we have lived in come back to us, we travel to the land of motionless childhood, capitalized. Motionless. The way all memorial things are. We live fixations of happiness. Comfort ourselves by reliving memories of protection. Something closed must retain our memories. Like a cup. That's what I'm thinking about. A cup. Something we can hold, we can deal with. That's the big old barrel. While leaving them their original value as images. Memories of the outside world will never have the same tonality as those of home. And by recalling these memories, we add to our store of dreams. We are never real historians, but always near poets. And our emotion is perhaps nothing but an expression of a poetry